Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Fans POV for ColossalCon 2016 in Sandusky, Ohio, at the Kalahari Resort and Convention Center. I'm your host, Chrissy Lawler. And with me is a very, very new face, as our new friend, Katie.
Hi!
Katie's a cosplayer who she's friends with, you know, that dumb one pirate. So she roomed with us for the weekend and we had so much fun together. All right, so this is Katie's first time, so she's going to be answering some of our questions. All righty. So, like I said, it's the Kalahari Resort and Convention Center. It also has a water park, mini animal, like zoo, feeding, petting.
That's my favorite.
Everything a little child would love. So, Katie, since this was your first time, what were your expectations going to ColossalCon?
Well, as a cosplayer, I came into it expecting a lot of bathing suits, and that was true, but I was really pleasantly surprised. A lot of people put so much work into said bathing suits. You would go out and you'd be like, oh, they're just doing a bathing suit cosplay. Then you'd look up front and you'd realize there are people who actually went out and bought the four-way stretch Lycra and made their bathing suits from the ground up. Like, just because it's a convention at a water park doesn't mean that the cosplayers who come don't put their heart and souls into it, just like any other convention where you'd go and you'd see armor. And actually, there was a lot of really beautiful armor work this weekend. I saw a ton of amazing makeup and prosthetics. At the Disney meetup, there was a Scar who had a full facial lion prosthetic. It was really intense. I was really, really pleasantly surprised.
Well, what was your first expectations coming just to the Kalahari?
I had no expectations. I had a horrible childhood, So I had never been to a water park before. I had never been in a hot tub before. I'd never been to Ohio before.
Ohio is forgivable.
Ohio's forgivable. So I really didn't know. And most of the pictures that I'd seen online were, you know, girls in the pool with bikinis and bathing suits. So that's kind of what I thought. But when I came here, the actual convention center is beautiful. And the panel rooms are really large and spacious. They have a lot of people allowed to go in them. The competitions that were here were really, really nice. A friend of mine participated in the wig competition and said the layout was really nicely done. And the masquerade, the way that they had the stage set up and stuff, was really nice too.
Alrighty. Since the Kalahari is a little different than our normal conventions, we'll talk about a couple of aspects. Like, what did you think about the pool area and like just the general locations for cosplay shoots or meetups?
In terms of meetups, at first I was really worried I wasn't going to know where to go because things were described as, for instance, the Savannah Plains area. And here I am thinking, like, the Serengeti Plains. And
just a patch of grass out front.
Just a patch of grass out front. But then there would be other things, like the actual water park. I cosplayed Little Mermaid this weekend, you know, expected. But it was gorgeous waterfalls and, like pool atmospheric kind of places. It was really good for photo shoots. I know people come here planning specifically like water themes or like specific armors or summer versions, and it was a really, really on point place for that.
No, I definitely agree. When we first came here last year, obviously most people, when they hear about ColossalCon, it's, to be honest, most people that I know of that I've spoken to have heard about it through videos. They haven't heard of more word of mouth. It's always been like CMVs, any vlogs from the con. So you visually see the con and that gets your attention rather than just word of mouth. Mm-hmm. And just the pool area is, and the water park are great for a cosplay shoot. There's a wide open field out there that's perfect for other kind of shoots. Like, you have a type of theme, the area has the perfect, like, different kind of sets.
It's not just what's expected either. For instance, I'm really well known for my Snow White cosplay. There's a zoo here, and they have a room that's filled with birds where you hold out your hand with a little stick, and there's just thousands of birds. And that would be a great photo op for Snow White with all of her bird friends. Like,
we wandered the whole thing and went, wow, we need you in Snow White right now.
Yeah, and it's just things like that. And I think people come here with certain expectations, and mine were completely blown in the other direction. fun. I mean, now I'm planning, I'm thinking, okay, well, now I kind of want to do, like, UA with, like, the cape and stuff and, like, coming out of the water. And, like, I mean, you don't necessarily have to keep it to, like, a bathing suit here, which is really nice. And I don't think people realize that when they hear Colossal Con. I think they hear swim party and think you can only wear a bathing suit cosplay. Right. But the actual convention hall was really nicely AC'd. Like, there were people in full Halo costumes and stuff, and it was definitely reasonable. There were a ton of fursuiters, which I was surprised of, given that it's the middle of the summer, but they set it up really nicely for that.
So. Sorry, I had dessert. because people can't, we can't make decisions, and as soon as one person makes a decision, then everyone realizes, oh, I should have done that too.
Okay, well, I didn't know I was hungry, and then you brought that dinner. I was like, dang, that looks good.
Well, it's still open for a little while. You still got your. Yeah, this weekend was Katie's birthday. Happy birthday.
Yeah.
Pirate's birthday. Yep. He's older.
Old man.
It was also our one cosplay photographer friend, J-Ron. It was his birthday too. Happy birthday. We'll see you at Icon. But we also, which was surprising for me, I know you had quite a few friends here. We actually saw quite a few friends here. And last year, I think we ran into like three. This year, all of a sudden, there was like 10. I think you said you had your Canadian friends. This was their first Colossal Con?
No. Actually, the reason I came to Colossal Con was because my Canadian friends recommended it to me after having had such a fun time. I know for them, it was about a four or five hour drive from Canada to
lucky.
Come here. I know, lucky. For me, from Pennsylvania, it was like, what, six and a half?
I think it was 6.5, and it had taken us like 3 to 4 hours to get to you.
To pick me up.
And then we got here, yeah. So it's a nice, from New York, it's a nice road trip.
But yeah.
You live in the damn country.
It's actually really interesting. A lot of us who are Disney cosplayers know each other via the Diz boards. And so one of my friends from Florida had flown up, two of my friends from Tennessee. Another friend was from Ohio. She just like drove down the road, lucky.
Right.
And then my friends from Canada. And so it was kind of, this is the convention where you can meet people not just from like the United States.
Right. Well, I think I heard some people, they were all talking in the hallways. Like there was some people from California here.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like, it's a small, like, convention-wise, it's small, but venue-wise, it's huge. Because everyone comes for the venue, not just the, not really much the con. Let's start going down our topic list. We're going to rearrange the order because we want John in here for one of them. We'll do Dealer's Room and Artist Alley. So what did you think about the Dealer's Room and Artist Alley?
I'm actually, even though I'm a cosplayer, I'm a professional illustrator, and I know a lot of people who do Artist Alley as their full-time job. I will say the Artist Alley here was incredibly small. It was probably the same size as Setsucon. If you guys have ever been to Setsucon, Winter Setsucon, back when it was at the Penn Stater before it moved, it's about roughly that size, probably a little bit smaller. The Artist Alley was very, very small. But the artists that were there knew how to bring in sales. I talked with a lot of them. They had really wonderful merch. I kind of went crazy in there because that's me.
Yeah.
They were all really, really nice too. And there was a lot of artists that I hadn't seen in the convention circuit much. I did see Yo Wolf there. I saw her at KatsuCon. She's amazing. Look up her Instagram. I was actually surprised she came to Colossal Con because I didn't know she was going to, so I was happy to see her. But it was still pretty small, so unless like you are a convention, you do every convention like Yo Wolf, I'd say it's more for, I felt like it was more local artists, as far as I talked.
There was a couple I saw that you see them at every convention.
Dealer's Room was really big to me, at least. I mean, because not necessarily in terms of how many booths, but what merch they had and the type of merch. You would see, you know, kind of the knockoff dealers. You see at every Dealer's Room, but then you would also see people who had really legitimate merch. I love Snow Miku. She's very... There. You asked me about merch.
I know, I did.
You asked me about merch. I collect Snow Miku specifically, the figurines of it. And I was really surprised. There was a booth that had 3 Snow Fairy Mikus, which most dealers never have that. I already have it, so I was good. But then there was another dealer who had the new 2016 Snow Miku there on the shelf, ready to buy. And I was like, is that the newest one? And I, like, you know, flipped, like, my mind blew up.
Yeah, we know. We heard about the whole night.
But like, to me, that's what would be a good dealer's room, is one where you can, as if you are someone who's really into merch, you can go there and find the newest merch that you are specifically looking for, and you can haggle for it. That's the point of going to a dealer's room rather than just doing it online. Versus if you're a newbie and you don't know the merch, there were lots of people who had, you know, really good old school Miku figs for like $20 or $30. So it, just from my point of view, it was a good dealer's room in terms of breadth of types of merch and who could possibly buy it.
Okay. I kind of walked around the dealer's rooms. Like we've been saying recently, we've been doing so many big cons that it's actually kind of nice to step back and do a smaller con. And these rooms, the Artist Alley and the dealer's room, to me felt like definitely a small con. Not necessarily a tiny, like, first-time con, but small enough where it's like it's a comfortable size.
It's manageable.
Manageable. You can walk around and not be like, oh, God, how long have I been in here?
It's not Otakon.
No.
It's not Otakon.
It's not Otakon. It's not Katsukon. So, but it was a nice, manageable. And they had... I don't always recognize all the dealers. You recognize the artists more because you can recognize their
style,
their art style and certain pieces. But the dealers, you can always tell, okay, that guy's got the manga, that guy's got the keychains, that guy's got the notebooks and folders and binders. This guy doesn't look like he belongs in an anime convention, but I've seen that stuff before. So it's definitely
Are you talking about the steampunk booth?
Yeah, steampunk booth. There's always a steampunk booth or a Ren Faire booth.
Yeah.
Which is fun. Well, fine, my bing. I like that stuff. But also I found it quite interesting was and it left my mind. All right. Okay. Maybe I'll get back to it. What we'll talk next is ColossalCon has what not everybody else has. I believe there was, in the beginning, they had a couple of booths in the dealer's room that said they would buy your used merchandise. And then there was also, they had two rooms on Sunday. I think they were event rooms that they turned into dealer's rooms. Well, what it is you filled out a form and they had a flea market and you could have your own table and sell your own shit.
I had never seen that at a convention. No. I didn't even know ColossalCon had that, and I think it's an amazing idea because, for instance, I have a friend. She's going to know who this is if she sees this video. She collects JoJo's Bizarre Adventure merch. She is the largest collection I've ever seen in my life, but she's actually scaling it down. But these are really expensive figurines, and it's like, where do you sell this stuff? How do you, and I mean, aside from like online trading forums, which can get sketchy, like who do you trust? Versus if you can go to a convention and not only like meet other people who like the same merch, but also haggle out what you like with someone who knows what that's worth in order to give it to someone who you know they're gonna care about it. Like, that's the beautiful thing about thrifting.
Mm-hmm.
And I love thrifting. I'm a thrifter. but like the fact that that was there was awesome. And I know a couple people. I know the Canadians got some merch. I know a couple of my other friends did too. And that was a great way for them to not only find affordable merch, but be a part of like the sustainability concept.
Oh, yeah.
But in terms of conventions, it was.
Well, that's like we had found out about it, I think literally on Sunday last year. Chris had walked in on one, so this year we knew about it at least. I was thinking about bringing my own stuff because I've got a bunch of animes and mangas I want to get rid of, but I was bringing too much to the con anyway, and I didn't want to have to bring more. But it was nice looking around. You saw old stuff that you'd never see anywhere else. Like, I actually saw a dealer who had some old Sayuki DVDs, and I'm like, oh my god. You don't have the one I need. But I'm like, but at least you see it. It's like going to a comic book shop or something like that, where you find that really old merchandise that nobody has. And you maybe luck out that somebody has with, like, I bought a couple of Bleach manga. I'm not going to lie. And then I went back to the dealer's room and bought more Bleach manga. But it's just, it's different, it's nice, and it also, it's not like people had to buy a table in order to do it. They basically, what they said was they had to fill out a form, and they could go in there, and they just had to have prices set up or some kind of bargaining system set up, and that was it. But I said to Ernie when I went in, what I think some should do is, like, if I had done that, I would have put a sign up saying, I'm looking for certain merchandise, want to trade. Like, say I was looking for a certain DVD out of a set, or maybe a manga number volume out of a set. I think that could work between the different dealers.
You know, it actually, I've since, I don't do it as much, but I used to be really into the Lolita community. And for Lolita meetups, they have something called a swap meetup, which is where you go, you take all the Lolita merch you don't want anymore, like my skirts, my petticoats, I don't want those anymore. I take them to the thing, and somebody else might want those. It might be their size. And you say, okay, you know what? what? I'll trade you my petticoat for that Baby the Stars Shine Bright hair clip. You know what I mean? Things like that. And I like the fact that that trading mentality is branching out not only into other aspects of the community, but as part of an actual convention menu. That, like, I can plan for that at the convention and say, you know what? I won't just bring the cosplay I'm wearing. I'll bring cosplays I want to get rid of.
Right. Like, I think it's still a couple people who had cosplays they wanted to get rid of. Posters, games, figures, books, DVDs. I think this one guy had on the floor, and it looked like old movie, just a bunch of old movie posters. They make me felt, it kind of like, I felt disappointed because my sister and I used to collect them when she used to work in the movie theaters. We used to collect all those movie posters, and I'm like, oh man, they probably were worth something now if we hadn't thrown them all out when we moved. But, all right, so we're going to move on. I know Ernie went to the masquerade. That had been, I think it ran a little late. He unfortunately didn't stay through to the awards. He did film the whole masquerade. He tried putting it up on YouTube, but of course, like, I think a song or something got banned in one location and something got banned in another. He is working on it. He will get it out to you people. Trust me, we want you guys to see this stuff. If you have seen our cosplay music video already, the performance in the beginning, I forgot the character's name from Zootopia. She was actually like the opening entertainment while everyone got into the room. Yeah. You know the cosplay.
I do. Her name is Lady Ava Cosplay. If you look her up, she's amazing. She's such a sweetheart. She was one of the judges for the masquerade, and she had been working for a really long time on Giselle from Zootopia, okay. Which is basically Shakira as a gazelle, and did an amazing job, and she rhinestoned it and everything, and was like, this is a performance character in the movie, how about using that as the opening, hi, welcome to the masquerade, and so in that video, when you see that, that's her performance, and she actually does the lip singing and the dance and stuff, so yeah. It looked really good, I was super proud.
Well, that's why Ernie threw that in there, because it was also a perfect song, and it tied into the convention, plus the music video. I do believe there was more, but that goes more into panels, so I think we're going to have to call in John. John was our... John, you know him. He's our panel guy. All right, John I.
Yeah.
What did you think of the Dealers and Artists, Sally?
Dealers Room was actually pretty good. I came here kind of expecting this to be like more of a vacation con and kind of a hangout con than an actual like...
Con?
The actual con, Leah. Yeah. I wasn't expecting it to be like Otakon-y, you know. Right. But so I was surprised at the amount of stuff in the Dealers Room. There was actually a good amount of stuff. Dealers Room and the Artist Alley and actually the Sunday
flea market.
Yeah, the flea market is a really cool idea for those who have never been to ColossalCon before. Basically, people bring in their own stuff to sell. It's kind of like a big garage sale of anime and manga,
yeah,
figures, toys. Well. It's really cool, and I'm actually probably gonna next year bring in some of my own stuff. So.
Same here.
Yeah.
All right. I know this is a stupid question, so we're going to skip it. You bought stuff.
Yes.
He's got his Shrine O' John in the corner over there.
Yes.
But because we always go to you, John, with this stuff because we are bad, bad congoers. Tell us about the panels and any like little special events that you attended.
Yeah, sure. So let's start with the events first. So there was a concert on Sunday. It was... the Symphonic Anime Orchestra. They actually made the joke and how SAO is their acronym, and they're like, no, we were SAO before SAO. The other SAO I'm referring to is Sword Art Online, of course.
I think ColossalCon, this is not their first time. I think they did it. No, they did it last year. I don't know if it's an ongoing thing. I have a feeling it might be.
Yeah. They sounded like they've been here before. They were pretty good. They did some good songs. I heard them like... I didn't stay for the whole thing, but they were like rehearsing Kingdom Hearts music at the beginning. And they did music from SAO. Anyway, as far as panels go, there was some pretty cool stuff going on. There was a very interesting panel that I went to on video game conspiracy theories.
Oh, everybody's into conspiracy theories right
nowadays.
Yeah,
where they talked about some of the creepypasta that had developed from video games. A couple examples, the Ben Drowned conspiracy theory from Majora's Mask and the Sonny the Tragic Clown from The Sims. Pretty interesting things I had never known before about these games and you know, how the programmers kind of snuck things in. Well, sometimes it was the programmers sneaking things in, sometimes it was just fan stories that were completely made up to sound spooky. But, you know, both ways, very interesting. Another interesting panel I went to was one on rhythm games, which was actually brought to us by the folks at Tokyo Attack. They're the ones who bring in all the DDR machines, all the Taiko Drum Master, Sound Voltex, basically any rhythm game you see at a convention. There's a good chance it was brought to you by Tokyo Attack, especially on the East Coast. I don't know how well they're known on the West Coast, but yeah, there was a really good panel on rhythm games that run by them. They just basically ran through a list of rhythm games, talked a little bit about each one, talked about some of the lawsuits that Konami had thrown at people. So it was pretty cool and educational. Another interesting one I went to was the Zero Escape panel. Zero Escape is the series starting with 999 on the Nintendo DS, and Virtue's Last Reward was the sequel on the Vita and 3DS, and then coming soon, I think in about a week, which is probably up by the time you're watching this, is the final installment, which name escapes me right now, but it's a series by Kotaro Uchikoshi, a series of visual novels slash puzzle games that is pretty popular among... it has a fan following. And then last but not least was the... So this guy cosplayed as the Dorito Pope.
And yeah, I've seen him around at other conventions.
Yeah. Yeah, he was wearing like a Pope hat, but it was made to look like a giant Dorito though, and he ran a panel, and he was
wasn't his stick made out of Mountain Dew cans or bottles.
He had a staff made out of Mountain Dew cans and bottles, and it was actually filled with Mountain Dew, and people were coming up to him during the panel and confessing their video game their gamer sins, such as thinking Daikatana was a good game or 100%ing Sonic 06. You know, people would come up to him and say, I did this, and he would have them kneel in like this kiddie pool, and he would pour Mountain Dew on them to absolve them of their sins. It was really funny. He also gave his E3 predictions, and he was basically like, everything's gonna suck. It was pretty awesome.
It was just like a panel just to relax and just kind of like, let's just goof off and have fun and not take anything seriously.
Yeah, yeah. I saw someone video. We weren't videotaping that one, but I did see someone videotaping that. So check out that panel. I would just search for Dorito Pope Colossal Con 2016. You'll probably find it.
Yep. Alrighty. I know there was a musical guest. Kaza was actually here. Did you go to see her?
No, I actually didn't know any of the musical guests. Okay. I meant to check them out, but there was other stuff going on that I would have rather been at, so I didn't get a chance
to. Okay. All right, John. Well, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
I will call for you later for ratings and all their final questions.
All right, very good.
Thank you, John.
Thank you.
Back of the field. Alrighty. If Katie wants to come back, she can come back. Because the next question is important. It is important because you are a part of it. Cosplay. One of the important parts of the con. Though some people will debate that. But you know what? Each part is important.
It comes together.
It does come together.
It's like a well-rounded meal.
Yes. We got a little bit of panels. Got a little bit of dealers and buying stuff and spending all your money. And then there's all the there's the cosplay stuff, which is all the money spent before getting to the con.
I think, as far as I'm concerned, I feel like conventions, it used to be mostly about the panels and dealers room. That used to be the meat of the convention. And now I feel like, at least for this convention, cosplay and photo shoots and meetups was definitely the meat of the convention.
Yeah, each convention is different. Like KatsuCon, I could say cosplay.
Cosplay.
Otakon, it's the con.
Well, Otakon for me was always dealer's room.
Dealer's room and the con.
That dealer's room is huge.
Oh, yeah.
Like, mind-blowing.
If you were to say Dragon Con, that's a little bit of everything, because it's the meetups, it's the cosplay, it's the dealers, and it's the special guests.
The special guests.
So every con, it just depends on, I think it depends on the venue and how it's run. This one, it's the venue, so it's cosplay. Just like KatsuCon, it's the venue, it's cosplay. When it comes to cosplay, did you see any particular trends besides water themes?
You know, that's actually, I think for me, I was really surprised, and I'll say, balls to the wall, people went for cosplay. There was an Undertale group where they did Goat Mom and... like a whole bunch of other characters, and they did full fursuits with movable parts and eyes and stuff. And you looked at it and you're like, what? Like, it just blew my mind. I know you said you saw the Joker and Penguin. Their prosthetics, their costumes, their method acting, all on point. I talked with one of the members of the main six who do Halo at BronyCon. I know you guys saw him. He's really funny.
Yeah. He sounds so familiar, but it could be a voice change, or I don't know.
I don't know, but I know I have a, like, Lady Ava, the one who was the judge, she goes to BronyCon, and I know that I've seen him online before, and so I was actually talking to him about his costume and how he made it, because I was looking at it, and I'm sure lots of people have done Halo costumes. You've seen them. They're very bulky, but they normally are hard to walk in and move in because of how it moves, and he was moving so fast and light. And I was like, what did you make that out of? And it was just the foam that you get at Home Depot. If you guys are cosplayers and you've ever worked with it before, that stuff is very hard to cut without it crumbling. He said he took a little knife, he would heat it up, and he'd cut it in small pieces, and as soon as it would get, like, too cold, he would have to take it out, clean it off, and reheat it. So we're talking, like, lots and lots of time.
Painstakingly. Time and detail.
So, all of the cosplayers I talked to knew their craft, and even those who didn't, I know you said you and Ernie cosplayed for the first time, things like that. I liked the fact that this convention was so, like, accepting of everyone. I could see some of the people, it was probably their first time, just wore a bathing suit and a wig, but they still had just as much of a blast as the rest of us who, like, went hardcore. So I was really impressed. I didn't come here expecting, I mean, that probably sounds horrible to the people who worked really hard on their bathing suits. I'm sorry. I didn't come here expecting to be blown away by, like, the amazing cosplays, and I really was. I had more fun watching the other people's cosplays than I did wearing my own.
I always do. It's just so much fun seeing all the detail work and the, like, the creativity that people put into cosplays. Like, I think I said it last year, like, there's some cosplay, yeah, it's just a bathing suit, but there's other times you have to put in details so that, and creatively do the details so that other people know who you are. And some of these people are just amazing when they did them. I personally didn't see any trends. Like, you always had you got your Disney group, you got your, you know, video game groups, you got your Sailor Moons, you got your Pokemon. So there was a nice even out, though I did see a bit more wrestling cosplays than I normally do. The wrestling cosplays seemed becoming a thing. Me and Ernie personally, that's what we, Ernie and I both cosplayed wrestlers this weekend. Ernie cosplayed one of the members of New Day, who
was he was the whole tag team. That's why he had different.
Oh, that's why he had so many pieces on. He was all three in one.
Yes.
Okay, Ernie was all three in one, and I did WWE Attitude Era Diva Lita. Which was funny because we were originally supposed to have a group, but a few people dropped out on us.
Why am I getting with that?
Because you were one of them.
I just dropped out.
You were supposed to be Grandmaster Sexay.
We didn't have a Sky to Hottie.
Oh my God.
Whatever.
My fault.
Whatever.
I'm here.
Whatever. But it's just.
John Cena. We know how much.
You didn't think that through. But it was just that I've seen a little bit more, but that just in general, not just here, I've seen a lot more people doing wrestling cosplays. Like our friend Kira, she loves doing cosplaying wrestlings. And she actually does them so on point that she gets retweets and regrams on Instagram and Twitter from the actual superstars, and she starts freaking out. And we're like, well, you must be doing something right.
I will say, I think wrestling kind of falls in this, but there was a lot of cosplay I'd seen that was kind of out there. Like, I wouldn't have thought about it. There was a girl I stopped and actually was that crazy, oh my God, which I'm never that person at a convention. She was cosplaying Mint from Threads of Fate, which was an original PlayStation game that no one ever talks about that was amazing. And when I saw her, I was like, wait, what? Not only does someone know about this game, they're cosplaying it. And there was a lot this weekend that was like a head turner. Like,
oh, yeah.
Did I just see that kind of a thing? More so than I'd say KatsuCon. I feel like KatsuCon, like, it's kind of, you know, you go in expecting certain things and everyone lives up to those expectations. expectations. This not so much. There was a group that did like traditional Hawaiian, but with the Pokemon starters.
Right.
That was really cool. They had like all of like the different like lei colors and the wings that expanded and stuff. Like very creative.
Yeah. Like there was at one point I think random and obscure is becoming more popular, but it's also mashing up. Like at one point, I didn't see them personally, but I saw pictures of them. Some people, I thought it was just the Disney princess, but they did a few other characters like anime and video games, and they did like Victoria's Secret model versions of them. Then I saw a character from Reboot. I saw,
which was awesome.
That was fantastic.
Awesome.
But yeah, a lot of like random stuff that you would never expect, and you just like, that's what you, that was good. Got you.
Yeah.
That was awesome.
Yeah.
Other than yourself or one of your roommates, favorite cosplay and why? And I have a feeling I know which one you're going to say.
Okay, well, you said not my friends.
Well, not like roommate friends.
Okay. She's going to blush when she hears this, but probably Ava's Giselle.
Giselle? Okay.
You know, because I think a lot of people looked at the character and said, oh, it's just like a simple top and a simple skirt bottom. And I know how much work.
Horns are hard.
Horns are really hard. But I know how much work she put into it. Not only does it film beautifully, it was beautiful on stage with like all the sparkles and stuff. And then she actually did the routine from the movie, which is not an easy dance.
No.
So I thought that was pretty amazing. I mean, I could go on.
I thought
on.
You were going to say the Threads a fate one.
Oh no, well my brain is still fried just even contemplating that.
We're Tuesday night right now.
Not like that's how shocked I was to see that. I didn't even recognize the character at first because I was not expecting anyone to know that game. I still get teary-eyed. When I posted it on Instagram, one of the girls from NPC literally just screamed, oh my God, is that a mint? And it's like, we've talked about it because no one ever knows those games, like the earlier games. And it was like, yeah.
There are times I'll mention like a show or something. And I think one or two times I've seen cosplays from it. And I'm like, that show. And then my friends are looking at me like, what show? And I'm like, who are you people? Yeah. Why am I friends with you?
Here's an example. Susanoo Gargantia, Gargantia on the Virtuous Planet, is up on Netflix now. And I figured everyone would know it now that it's up on Netflix. This is what I'm talking about. No one watches it.
I lived under a rock all my life.
Yeah. So did I. I've never been to a water park. And I was really, I
blame Chris for that because he's the one who got me to water parks too.
I was expecting a lot of that here. I only saw one Amy cosplayer and it kind of makes me bummed because I was going to bring my Amy from that. It's one of the characters from that. And I was expecting more of that, things like that. So then when I saw her, I was like, yeah. So things like that. There's so much cosplay this weekend. I was so pleasantly surprised.
Chris, you got a favorite?
Kung Fury and.
Oh my!
Why am I so surprised?
I'm
not surprised at all.
There was a Triceratops. It was three of them. It was Kung Fury, Hackerman, and Triceratops. And I'm like, oh my God, yes.
You should not be surprised.
I actually forgot about it. So that's why.
There was a really good Macho Man too.
There was another Macho Man.
Bunch of Slim Jims.
Oh God! Of course he did.
Really happy about it.
I think John's in the bathroom, so otherwise I'd ask him. I know my favorite cosplay of the weekend happened Friday. It was that Joker and Penguin from the Arkham video games. Like you said, they were so on point. They had the limps, the way they walked, the accents, their mannerisms. They were freaking perfect. Like they had a group later on that day with Catwoman, Riddler, Harley. But the two of them
were
on it. John. Favorite cosplay of the weekend?
Didn't you?
See many cosplays?
Because you were in panels.
What?
Because you were in panels?
Because he was in panels.
Okay, no, it's all right.
Any Love Live cosplays?
I knew it. I was going to say the Love Live group because I remember you mentioning that.
But no, like the cosplays this week, like I said, it's when it comes to anime conventions, anything goes now. It's kind of like anime cons are turning into comic cons, except for most
walking
of
Dead
it.
Ariel was really cool too.
There was a Walking Dead Ariel.
There was actually a group that was walking around, and I don't know if she was part of it or not, the one you're talking about, but there was a lot of Disney crossovers this weekend. One of them was Disney princesses, like you said, with Victoria's Secret models. There was also the Walking Dead crossover. There was
crossovers is becoming the thing. That's becoming like, we always joke about the cos plague, which is the trend that takes over everything. Like, one year it was, for a couple of years it was Italia, for a couple of years it was Homestuck, then it became Attack on Titan. Now it seems to be mashups are coming the thing, and I actually like that because that requires, it's original, it requires thought and detail work.
I'll say for me personally, I have mixed feelings about it, because sometimes
it doesn't play true to the
character, and that kind of kills a little bit for me. I'll be straight up right here. I'm not a big fan of Slave Leia crossover with anything.
Well,
but that's me personally. Right. I've still seen people do that like crossovers with it or that specific cosplay and blow it out of the park in terms of craftsmanship. So hail to them. As an illustrator, I will say, 9 times out of 10, the original idea comes from an illustrator's actual illustration that just ended up on Tumblr and then ended up people being like, "Wow, that's really cool. I wish I could make that into a cosplay."
And usually they do.
I know that the historical Disney princess lineup, where you see them, where it's like Ariel in the one ball gown and Cinderella has the stripes,
Megara's really in an actual
Greek toga, things like that. At KatsuCon, the Disney Art Nouveau group that was based off of an illustrator's work.
They won a couple awards at the masquerade.
And the thing of it is it's not, to me, that's the union between Artist's Alley and the cosplay, because a lot of times those artists are artists in the Artist's Alley, so people will plan those groups for the conventions they know the artist is at, and then they'll be able to do a meetup.
Well, that's like my one friend who loves our page model Lost Dreams. Her and I fangirl over Tsubasa. She has so many Tsubasa cosplays planned out, and a few of them are art she saw online, either Tumblr, DeviantArt. I think there's one piece she really has her heart set on. One day she'll do it. It's not in the near future, and it's an elf version that was a fan manga. It was a fan doujinshi. So she's just the artists out there come up with so many fantastic ideas for existing characters and costumes. It's just amazing. Yeah. All right, so let's move along. Highlight and low light of the con. So we'll do low light first.
For me as a cosplayer, I think hotel rooms are super duper important. Even though we were blessed with like the most prime location for a hotel room, the hotel itself had like a lot of issues. I know it took me 4 or 5 days until I actually had a warm shower. It was like ice cold.
The room we have is a two bedroom room where it's two couple double beds. We have the king in there, but like size of a room, obviously there's two bathrooms. One didn't have hot water in the shower.
And no one told me because y'all are assholes.
I didn't know it either. I had used the other bathroom.
The boys didn't say anything, so
I think what it is nobody realized it.
So
we did have a few issues with our room.
Yeah, the AC had issues.
The first day.
Our key card had issues. And I know that, like, for instance, the water park, the closing times were weird sometimes.
The pool was weird. The restaurants, their times are weird.
The restaurant times were bizarre.
Well, because one of the restaurants in the hotel, the buffet, is dependent on the occupancy of the hotel. So I'm sure earlier in the weekend it was really busy. But as the weekend started to die and there was less people in the hotel, they decided,
open. Yeah, and so for me as a cosplayer, like, I'm really particular about that things because I have to have my shower at a specific time so I can be up, so I can get my makeup done, like all that kind of stuff, and it just threw it off. I think the one day I woke up at 1:30 or something like that. Like, I have never woken
that
up.
That was a sleeping issue the night before.
I have never woken up that late in my life for a convention. So that kind of threw off photo shoots and stuff. And I my other friends who stayed in this hotel had same problems with their rooms, so we weren't not the only ones.
Okay, so we weren't the only ones. Also, to highlight a couple of things, we actually found out from a hotel employee that actually in previous years it wasn't true, but this year we took over the Kalahari. Every hotel room in this convention was a convention goer. It was at the convention rate and everything. We took over this hotel. Obviously, outside people could come and use the restaurants, could go to the water park and the pool, but the hotel rooms were us. So I'm sure they were also probably a little bit overwhelmed at the capacity at which the water was used and all that kind of stuff.
I'm not blaming the hotel. No, just, you know.
Because, to be honest, even though there were some issues, they were very nice about everything. They were very helpful.
The staff here has been the nicest at any hotel, let alone at a convention hotel, that I have ever stayed at.
Yeah, well, while we're going out there, we'll talk about a little bit about the hotel. When we came in, we found some things in the hotel room we were kind of surprised at, and we found a letter from, apparently they put in every hotel room, they put in extra garbage bags, they put in makeup wipes, and I believe they put in some extra stuff like extra soaps and shampoos, because they knew this is stuff that people and congoers used. They knew that people were going to use a lot of garbage, accumulate a lot of garbage, so they flat out said that, oh, if you have garbage, here's extra garbage bags. If you've got a full bag, put it outside your room by a certain time and we'll clean it up. They didn't actually come in every morning. They knocked on the door and just asked if we needed certain supplies, and that's what all they gave us.
They also were very well aware that convention goers get up at disgusting hours and go to bed at disgusting hours. So I would have friends who would get up super duper early in the morning for morning panels, and they would open up breakfast early for them, or they would have coffee even though the bar wasn't open. And then the first night, Thursday and Friday night, Chris and I, we were up so late, and we went to go to the restaurant to go eat, and they were kind of closing up. They were closing up the tables and everything, and the guy who was the maitre d' was like, it's okay, come sit down, we'll feed you anyways. We'll see what they still have open, and we'll make sure you get fed. So, I mean, and that's going above and beyond their paycheck, let alone what's normal at a hotel. And everyone here, regardless, was like that. I mean, I'll admit there were a couple lifeguards who had a little bit of attitude, but they're lifeguards. I've been there. I know how that is.
Yeah. Well, so they also had to deal with outside people, so who knows?
Who knows?
Who knows if... with all the congoers on top of all that, probably.
On top of all that.
Because they have certain rules to adhere to, and I'm sure it's a little tough with cosplayers at the pools.
I will say a rule that I was surprised about, for those of you who are planning to come to ColossalCon next year, you cannot use inflatables in the pool. So if you're like doing a Haru from Free and you want to bring an inflatable like dolphin for a photo shoot,
not in the pool.
You cannot bring it in the pool. You can stand next to the pool and pose with it, but you cannot put the inflatable in the pool. I know, because I got called out on that. So
we were doing a shoot at the water park in the wave pool, and we had it as a prop and we were allowed to hold it, but once it started going up in the air and getting flown around, like a little volleyball was kind of
inflatable. Was that the Pokemon volleyball?
Yeah. The Pokemon. She started playing with it in the water. Once that thing started moving around in the air, he said, no, you can't play with it. We could hold it, but we couldn't play around. Luckily, Ernie had gotten footage by that point. Also, a lot of people heard about this, I'm sure. The Kalahari opened up hotel rooms for next year if you were currently staying at the con. There was quite a... how do I put this? I have calmed down from this, so I'm not going to be nasty about it.
It's okay.
I stood online for 6 hours. I didn't get a room. We're not 100% sure of all the details. Some people heard it said that the hotel blamed the con. Some people heard the con say the hotel. Obviously, most of our information is he said, she said, hearsay. We do know for a fact that what it was is they opened at 5 p.m. Friday night. People were online for hours beforehand. Maybe if everyone had stayed online, I probably would have been online another 2 hours before, if they had still had rooms, before I would have gotten a room. They had only opened up certain block numbers of rooms. They used up Friday night's block of rooms, and they used Saturday afternoon's block of rooms. Someone said that they were planning on reopening Saturdays with another block, but we never heard 100% confirmation on that. The only other way to get a room after that was to call Monday morning at 10 a.m. We had a few phones trying.
We did like the phone monopoly thing where you all call at the same time and hope someone gets in.
It took, I think, Ernie.
2 hours altogether.
No. It was about an hour and a half before one of us got on.
Because we started what, like
10?
We started at like
10 o'clock.
We were ready. We were like calling at 10. Had your phone. Ernie had his. I had mine.
The only thing was weird was Ernie's phone. He kept calling the same number, and he always got that like ring busy signal. My phone. there was three numbers you could have called. There was the official one that they gave on the website. There was regular hotel reservations, and I think there was another hotel number.
There was because the hotel reservations had two numbers. You tried one. I tried one. You tried the other. Yeah.
What happened was is out of the three numbers, only one would connect for me. The other two, as soon as, you know how you, it says calling on the phone, and then all of a sudden it would just say call ended. It never even, like, connected.
That's how Ernie's and I were.
So mine, I went with that third number. It would always ring, and then busy signal, ring the busy. I finally got through, and we were able to get a room. We heard about two and a half hours, so about noon, 12:30. The hotel was officially booked.
It was officially booked. So
you cannot, you cannot at this moment get a hotel room in the Kalahari. Obviously, Plaza Khan said it, the Kalahari said it. People do cancel rooms due to certain reasons, whether it's financial problems, personal problems, they can't come to the con, not enough people in the room. So do try and call, maybe wait like a couple months, not call in the next 2 weeks, maybe starting September, October, when people start really putting down, try calling the Kalahari, see if rooms open up. We do have a warning. We saw it like within an hour or two of on Monday. There are scalpers online with rooms for the Kalahari on Craigslist and such. The Kalahari and the Colossal Con both recommend, if you see this, get their information and contact the Kalahari Resort in Sandusky, Ohio, because that is illegal. They cannot be doing that. And if they are caught doing that, they will lose their reservation. So we are warning you out there, if you want Kalahari rooms, do not give in to scalpers.
I know that for me personally, a lot of times I don't actually, like for instance, that's how I was with you guys. I found they were, you know, looking for roommates and I already knew Chris, so I had more of a little in than other people. But they're normally for conventions, almost every single convention, there will be a group for, hey, I'm looking for a roommate, our friends dropped out, can you help us fill the position? Honestly, that's normally the best way to go about it.
And they also, in those groups, I know Kalahari has it, Classicon has it in the same group, some have it in separate. You can find, like, hey, I live in this area, anybody else in this area have a room in their car?
Carpooling. Because that's how you guys were for me.
Yeah. Well, it's also, we ended up with two roommates that way because we had some last minute call out cancels. But I think Ernie did that. It didn't work out, but he tried that way because, like, if people are going past the airport, because the Cleveland airport is about an hour away from the Kalahari. So obviously it's not something that the hotel can do a shuttle. If it was like 20 minutes, the hotel would do a shuttle. So you could contact, like, say my flight comes at this time, anybody driving by the airport can give me a ride to the Kalahari. I'll give gas money. So we will always be there for each other, so just keep a lookout. Try on the Colossal Con homepage, and they also have a cosplay page and homepage, and it's more like a group thread.
Yeah,
and then there's also the room and transportation thread. Okay. So those are really important. I want to get those out there. All right, we talked about your low light. What is your highlight of the weekend?
Wow, can getting to come count? Can that be a highlight? Can being here be a highlight? I don't know. Feeding those baby bunnies was pretty hot.
She almost let them smother her.
Yeah, they have an option at the zoo where you can, like, all the money. I will say this. Before I came to Colossal Con, I had heard so much dirt throwing on the boards about the fact that there are animals here and the fact that it's animal abuse and they have baby animals that you take pictures with and they maltreat their animals. I have a lot of friends who are zoologists who actively work with animals, and I will say the animals here are very well taken care of. So far as I've seen, they are well fed. They had such strict hours for the baby animals and how you can be near them. I know Chris said last year he asked if he could sniff the baby cat and they told him no. They're very specific.
It was a baby lion and I wanted to sniff him.
Okay, Chris. But, like, you see what I'm saying is I came here with the expectations that it would be very much a hoax to gain money for the hotel, and
all of the proceeds from taking photos with the animals goes back to the care and the conservation of said animals. I know.
I didn't think the prices were that bad either.
No, I know people were complaining. There were two. There was an alpaca and a llama that were walking around the convention grounds outside, and in order to take a photo with them, it was $15, and people were up in arms. $15
is nothing.
$15 to take a selfie with a llama? Are you kidding me? Do you have any idea how much it takes? How much it costs to take care of large animals like that? Like a lot. So,
well, it's also the fact that those animals, heaven forbid you should startle the animals and stuff like that. But I do know, I remember reading somewhere, I'm not sure the specifics behind it, but I believe they had wanted to do, where it's obviously natural, not toxic to the animals, they were going to, like, color the fur. And the Kalahari got such, like, threats. They almost didn't even bring them, period.
I have a comment on that. Both of my roommates that I live with in Pennsylvania are dog groomers. They're professional dog groomers. And the colors that they use on dogs, like, you know, if you've ever seen the funny ones where people turn their dog into a tiger, things like that, that is vegan dye. It is made from plants. The animals, you can eat that kind of dye. You can literally stick it. It's like the dye you put in your food for your cupcakes. And it does not go on the animal's face. So I will say that the Kalahari was not in the wrong there. It was people overreacting.
But obviously they have to take any kind of threat seriously.
So, I mean, we saw those same llamas today. They were gorgeous. They were so well taken care of. But, yeah,
they looked so happy every time they saw a bucket walk past.
I know. There was one llama who was rolling and rolling around. He was so cute. But, yeah, they have a photo op where they have a giant pen, and it's all these really well taken care of baby bunnies. And you could just...
baby bunnies.
They were like this big. And you could...
And they eat my fingers.
Yeah, yeah. We both have acrylic nails, and they kept trying to, like, nom, 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 nom. But, yeah, I was so tempting. I'd say the highlight of this convention is the fact that there is always something to do. There's nothing worse than going to a convention
and being bored.
Like, for instance, I'm a cosplayer. I do meetups. I very rarely go to panels. It has to be like something if they had a Cardcaptor Sakura panel, you and I would have been there in a heartbeat. But like, unless it's something oddly specific like that, it's
Bang
not
from the back row.
It's not going to be something I'm going to go to. So because of that and how conventions are for me, the minute that the photo shoots and the cosplay were over, it's like, what's there to do? Well, the beautiful thing is this convention, there's a water park, there's a giant arcade, there's laser tag, there's that
people chasing you around with cameras.
People chasing you around with cameras. There's a zip line. There's a zoo. I mean, it's an actual vacation resort. So for those people who aren't really into Dealers Hall, who their panels are over, like if, for instance, when John's panels are over, he could go to the hot tub with Chris and have a drink, which the drinks here were on point. But that
she enjoyed herself, I think.
I really did. This was a vacation I didn't know I needed. When I go to a convention, I always expect the stress, but there was none of that at this convention. It was amazing. I don't want to go home.
I had it all on Friday. we joke about it now. I'm not going to go hardcore with the guys. I'm just going to ask you a highlight, Chris. Besides the Kung Fury cosplayers and the little kitty bean feet, there was a baby bobcat.
There was a baby bobcat named Pearl, and Chris
wanted to kidnap him.
He lost his mind.
He's like freaking out now.
He's freaking out right now.
Beans!
Okay, I think that was the highlight for him.
Yeah, the highlight was the baby cats.
You got 5 seconds.
5 seconds.
Five, four, three, two, one.
Yeah.
He enjoyed the weekend just being here.
He loved it.
I had some damn good drink.
He had a good drink the other day. I don't want to scream into the mic. John!
Don't remember what was it.
What was your favorite part?
Highlight of the weekend.
Oh, God.
Dorito Pope.
Probably the Dorito Pope, yeah.
Dorito Pope? Okay.
Yeah, your face lit up when you talked about it.
All right. Just so you know, in the Kalahari, obviously everything is themed for a, like, animal, African theme. So we got some really weird, creepy paintings in the room. Like, we got this giant gorilla.
It's a giant gorilla painting right over where I was sleeping. I would wake up in the morning and be like, oh, hi.
We got cheetah and antelope. We got a lion in the other room. So there's a theme going on here. But my highlight, I think it's all the cosplays, just filming everybody. Like I said earlier, we actually saw a lot of people that are our friends that we normally don't see, which I was kind of surprised to see. Our cosplay page models, Sean Shazuhime and Legend of Link were here. Bruce Wayne cosplay was here. A couple of other friends, our one from Brittany, last minute, like a week and a half ago, apparently decided to come. So we ran into her. We ran into Solo Grayson, Mango Serene, Cortoon. Unfortunately, we weren't able to film with them because a lot of people I noticed this con, like Corey Starfire told us, everyone's starting to do cons a little more relaxed. They're not running around, oh, I got a photo shoot here, I got a photo shoot there, oh, I got to meet this photographer and that. Everyone's trying to calm down because I think it's just too much stress. Like, I know I spoke to Mango Serene about it. She'd had a medical issue a couple weeks, like a month ago, so she's got to calm down a little bit with that stuff and not push herself. She's still having fun just hanging out in cosplay, but she's not pushing herself photography wise. So it was really nice to see everyone and hang out. We got to hang out with Devin and Jay from AkaiCon. It's just a lot of fun getting to know the new roommates we had, because we had Bethany, who roomed with us at Katsu, but her friend Ember, Katie, Chris, and Katie's friend Amanda. It was just nice to have fun. I'm warning you, apparently you can change nicknames on the Facebook Messenger threads. Unfortunately, Amanda taught us how to do this, and now there are so many different nicknames, stupid nicknames on it. I'm Mom, so every time someone goes to leave the room, it's like, Mom, I'm going out, I'll see you later, bye. So this joke has gotten worse. But I think just in general, just having fun with everybody, not just the roommates, but everybody, just having so much fun with everybody. And these two idiots in the background joking around. All right, so we're going to go into our fun point ratings. On a scale of 1 to 10, 1 being the worst horrible thing ever, 10 being the most awesome thing ever, and why? I'm going to go with you. Let me get the calculator out because we need that.
I know.
Okay.
What did we get last time we did this? Some weird decimal because of Chris.
That's right. We did it on Periscope.
9.2 for me again.
Okay, yeah, we did it on Periscope the other night.
We started on Periscope the other night, and it was 8.24 something.
Okay, that's what it was. I think I gave it a 9. Ernie gave it
you
a 9.
Nine, because nothing is ever perfect.
But it was pretty close. Chris gave it like an 8.2.
9.2.
He wanted to do a weird decimal. I gave it, I think it was an 8, because I think I said like an 8 or an 8.5, something like that. Okay. Because specifically just because of the distance and the expense and how hard it was with the hotel room issues as a cosplayer.
Uh-oh.
Just going to say a little bit. Okay. Into the ratings.
Okay. All right. Well, we know what Chris had a 9.2. What did you say?
Okay. So I'm going to say a 7. Okay. And that's only because it's not personally my type of con. I still had fun. Don't get me wrong. The panels that I went to were good. But when I go to a con, I'm looking for what I would say for the as far as the panels go is more fan panels, more fun stuff, and less academic stuff. So what I would say when I go to panels, I'm usually looking for like half of the fun stuff, half like academic, like Japanese history.
I know you usually like industry panels too.
Yeah, industry panels are good too. I can live without those, but I would like some academics, like the stuff Charles Dunbar does. He wasn't here this year.
I think he was here last year, I think.
Yeah, so I don't know what happened this year. Would have liked to see him, but whatever. But as far as that, other than that, I would also say like just a lack of good guests. And again, I know this isn't the type of con that's really people would come here for guests. People generally come here just to hang out, cosplay, and just to, you know, go in the pool and have fun. But for my personal interests, I would just say like that's the main thing. So I would give it a 7 out of 10. I still had fun. It was a great con, and I will come back. It just wasn't everything I look for in a con.
Well, I think also what it was is when it's a first time, you have certain, like, I know you didn't have certain expectations, but you've been to so many cons and so many different types that you have certain expectations.
Right.
And yours is, like we said, it's mostly panel. This con, I can say for, like, having been here last year, this is, like we said, it's more of a relaxed con. The con knows it's not Otakon. It knows it's not KatsuCon. But they know that people come here for the venue. So they cater to certain things. They cater to the venue, they cater to the cosplayers. They do things a little different, like when it comes to like the orchestra, the way they do the panels and stuff, the flea market. So, oh, by the way, we got, I'm sure you saw the intro of the video. I was able to get a selfie with Chuck Huber. I was so happy to meet him.
Yeah.
I didn't think he had any autograph signings because everything in the app that ColossalCon had, it just said he had panels. It didn't say autograph signings because he just had a table in the dealer's room.
Yeah.
But I had given it a 9. It wasn't, you know, it can't be perfect. We can get close to perfect, but we can't be perfect. I didn't really enjoy it more than I expected to this year. After the issues on Friday night, luckily the shenanigans that were in the hotel room happened like right after we got back to the room, so it was able to kind of, after we mellowed out, fix it.
Not murder anyone.
So from the five of us, it was an 8.4. I think the other night, I don't think you gave a rating, and everyone else in the room had given a rating, so that's why it was different.
Yep.
But I did enjoy it. It seems everybody else enjoyed it, so it comes to the important question. We got the room, but so me, you, at least me and Ernie are coming back. So here's the question: you guys coming back?
Yeah.
I already spoiled that. Yeah, I plan on coming back.
Yeah,
Chris ain't coming back.
Chris.
So we will be back next year for ColossalCon. We will be. I believe the dates for next year. Obviously it's the first week in June, like it always is. Let me go through. Wow, I went too far. That's 2018, not 17. There we go. It is going to be. I believe it's the 1st through the 4th of June next year.
Yeah, that's right, because this year my birthday was on Thursday, and next year it's on Friday.
So it's obviously Chris and Katie's birthdays again.
It usually happens.
We will be posting all of our pictures on Facebook that we took, because we're actually doing more pictures than we used to. And obviously our friends have been taking pictures as well. If you want to see more of our footage, please subscribe here down here on YouTube. You can follow us on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, Tumblr.
Pinterest.
Well, not really Pinterest as much Pinterest anymore. Periscope. All the fans POV. Our homepage is www.thefanspov.com. The next time you see the fans POV will be at, if this airs before, it's Anime Next in Atlantic City, New Jersey this year. It is June. I'm horrible with dates.
It's this weekend.
Yeah, I know, but we gotta give dates. June 10th through the 12th.
Yep.
Ernie will be there, and then also at Eternal Con in Garden City, New York, June 11th and 12th, you will see Ricardo and our cosplay page model Nikki Hu. They will be there taking pictures and just hanging out and saying hi to everybody. So if you see them, say any three of them, please say hi. And that is it from us at ColossalCon. Thanks to Chris, Katie, John, Ernie already left, and all of our new roommates. We will see
Dad
you.
Left us.
We had a great time, and we will see you all later. Bye.
Bye.